Welcome to the CompTIA Tech Jobs Report for March 2024. Let's jump right in. The recent release of the BLS Jobs Report showed employment across the U.S. economy increased 275,000 new positions. The national unemployment rate increased to 3.9%. For the tech perspective, let's turn to CompTIA's Chief Research Officer, Tim Herbert. Hi, Tim.
Hi, Andrea.
So, Tim, what should we know about this latest report?
Well, it was one of those months that you have to scratch your head and wonder what happened to a few of the metrics. And that is to be expected. As we've discussed many times on this series, with the monthly data from the Bureau of Labor Statistics, there will be fluctuations. Some of the data may be up, some may be down, and some may be flat. If we look at the four key metrics tracked in the CompTIA Tech Jobs Report, we see that the tech industry employment number was in the positive, and that was driven primarily by tech services. We also saw that employer tech job postings were slightly positive as well, and the active postings were up, and then the new postings were essentially flat. We did see tech occupation employment dipped, and that typically goes hand in hand with the tech unemployment rate. So we have had a very low unemployment rate for a very long time, but it did increase slightly this past month. And that is a little bit unusual, just because we haven't seen that type of move in quite some time. And that really gets to the heart of our discussion today. There is so much nuance in the data. There are so many moving parts that sometimes we really want to dig into it a little bit deeper than just looking at the overall figures. So I'm going to do a quick rundown of five factors affecting tech employment. The first one, as you would expect, is companies that are hiring for growth. And the data in the accompanying chart comes from an upcoming study that CompTIA is about to release, our annual Workforce and Learning Trends Study. And this is based on a large-scale survey among HR professionals. So you can think of this as an audience that is very in the know in terms of hiring. And we found that a strong majority of HR professionals expect to be hiring for growth. So as their companies are looking to expand, they may want to develop new products. They may want to reach new customers. They may want to modernize. So often it comes with investments, in many cases, technology investments. And with that comes investments in additional headcount to support whether it's deployment, whether it's integration, whether it's moving into emerging tech. But typically that drives a large portion of the employment gains that we see. The next factor is hiring for replacements. So at any given time, roughly 7% of the tech workforce is exiting the labor market. These could be due to retirements, especially right now when you have a booming stock market. Workers that are just in that age range, they look at their 401ks, they're feeling pretty good, they may decide to retire. But workers could also leave for family reasons. They may decide to start their own business. They may go back to school. But there's a wide range of reasons why someone may leave. And then there's also what we refer to as the turnover rate. And these could be situations where an employee gets a promotion. An employee may decide to seek a new opportunity. They may seek advancement with another employer. But that's roughly another 30 to 35% of the total tech workforce is on the move. So employers have to plan for this. Oftentimes, they have to invest in additional training to move and to onboard employees into backfilling these positions. The next factor is layoffs. And we have to acknowledge this has been in the news quite a bit. And this, though, is the factor that tends to overshadow the other factors. The media will highlight when a company makes an announcement of layoffs, but they typically don't write the same type of story when a company is hiring or when a company is, say, backfilling for departures. But we do have a segment of HR professionals that do believe that they will experience some degree of layoffs. And again, this could be for any number of reasons. It could be a function of moving into growth areas. So they may be sunsetting a legacy business unit. It could be a function of their customers. For example, they may do a lot of business overseas. So it could be a function of how their overseas customers are performing. And that does segue into the next factor. And again, these often move in conjunctions. But many companies also expect that they will have transitions due to skills gaps. And this really defines the history of the tech workforce, that we sometimes refer to it as creative destruction. When companies innovate, they develop new technologies, which often means that there are obsolete technologies that fall by the wayside. And we see this over and over again. You can think back just a few years ago, the shift to cloud computing. That was a major transition that involved needing to transition many workers into new positions. So this is both an opportunity for workers that embrace change, that pursue upskilling, pursue reskilling, as well as employers. But it's also a cautionary note that workers that don't invest in their skills or companies that are not investing in their workforces, they can start to lag and they can fall behind. And then the last factor is hiring freezes. And this is one that, as you would expect, if there's uncertainty in the market, companies, they may become risk averse, they may decide to put hiring on hold. And this is something that some companies, they have to be really careful. You don't want to wait so long before you start to ramp up your investments or ramp up your hiring, because the market may move much faster and you could miss opportunities. So we went through five different factors, and these all happen simultaneously. So that does add to some of the complexity. And it's really what we try to do is to tease out the net effect of each of these different factors and to provide an overall picture of how the job market is performing. But generally, as we see, some will be in the positive, some may be flat, and some will be negative. But generally, as we've reported each month, for the most part, tech has performed quite well, and we tend to see more positives than negatives.
And taking a longer term view on the market, what do these trends show?
We do both across the economy, in many companies, and our own personal lives. We do tend to focus on the short term to such a high degree, whether it's the upcoming month or in some cases the upcoming week, that we can lose sight of the bigger picture. And oftentimes, we're not always looking off to the horizon and some of the perspective that comes with that. So we do try to make sure that we are providing that longer term perspective. When CompTIA publishes its annual State of the Tech Workforce, we do provide a 20-year snapshot. So 10 years of historical data, and then a projection 10 years ahead. And that really helps to smooth out some of the fluctuations that we see month to month. And it's also reassuring that all signs point to a continuation of the growth trajectory that we have seen in the tech workforce. Looking out over the next 10 years, we expect tech workforce to grow at about 2.2 times faster than the national benchmark. And this is where context is so important. It can be difficult to make sense of a single growth percentage. Is 20% good? Is it bad? But when you compare it to other occupations and the overall labor market, it really puts into perspective just how much faster tech is growing relative to the alternatives. And as we just discussed, there are a number of factors that mean employers have to hire even more workers than what is conveyed in the overall growth numbers. And that's because they have to backfill for workers that may retire or leave the labor market. They have to account for growth. They have to account for transitions, whether it's a transition into an emerging technology. So certainly artificial intelligence is top of mind right now, but it could be transitions into any number of new technologies. So overall, the long-term projection is looking quite good. And then if we delve into some of these specific occupations, many are growing at even a faster clip. So we see the continuation of growth in positions such as data science, data analytics, cybersecurity, software development, UI, UX. So some of these are growing at such a fast rate compared to the benchmark. And then if you go down the list, you also see positions that they're not growing quite as fast, but we have to remember that these are important stepping stone positions. So for example, even though tech support, IT support, the growth rate is not quite as high, but there's far higher transitions among these positions. So someone may work a year or two in tech support, and then they move on to network administration. And then from there, perhaps they move into cybersecurity. So we actually have to train and certify far more workers in these lower level positions because they're moving so rapidly into advancement. So it's actually numerically far more workers there than what the percentage would imply.
And taking a bigger view of the market, what do the longer term trends show?
Yeah, that's something that we see every single day. We look around all of the companies that we engage with, just how much technology is being used across every occupation. And at sometimes you see this referred to as the knowledge workforce, but increasingly we refer to it as the digital workforce. So these are tech-enabled jobs. And as a percent of the economy, as you would expect, it continues to grow. And the total numeric value of the digital workforce now stands at about 63 million. And you can think of this as a continuum from basic digital skills. Historically, you can think of it as using a computer. If you feel comfortable, say, typing an email or searching the internet, or using Microsoft Office products. So pretty basic digital skills, up through advanced digital fluency skills, which are far more advanced, and then finally into the core tech workforce. And we should acknowledge there is a little bit of a gray area. So the definition is not perfect, and there's some positions that you could potentially characterize as digital type of positions. So that number could actually be quite a bit larger. Last year, employers posted roughly 11 million job advertisements that cited a digital skill. And this is across every occupation category, across every industry sector. So it is a sign that employers are certainly hiring for these skills, and that is an expectation for many job roles. And we do corroborate this again, with the data in our soon-to-be-released workforce and learning trends. Among HR professionals, a growing number in the most recent study, it was roughly 75%, said that they do expect to evaluate candidates at a higher degree than previously for the digital skills that they have. So again, these are tech adjacent positions. And obviously if you work in a tech job role, you have a high degree of digital skills, but these are all of the occupations So whether you work in marketing or finance or operations or customer service or research, I mean, the list goes on and on. There is a need for those digital skills. And looking at the list of some of the higher ranked digital skills, and again, this goes well beyond, I think, you know, it wasn't too long ago where digital skills, again, would have been, are you familiar with using Microsoft Office products, Excel, PowerPoint? Are you familiar with basic applications? Today, it requires a far deeper portfolio of digital skills. So spanning cybersecurity, data, applications, of course, familiarity with devices. And we saw how important this became with the growth of remote work, where workers are often responsible for troubleshooting their own computer or printer or webcam. And then the new one to the list, and this is you know, something that moved up pretty quickly, was artificial intelligence. So the number of employers, and again, it doesn't mean that employers expect people to be an expert in large language models, but to have a basic awareness, a basic fluency in using, say, some type of generative AI application, ChatGPT, or some of the other ones out there. So yeah, that'll be something, and it's still pretty early. So I think companies are still trying to figure out how AI will fit within their workflows, within their processes. But still, that's pretty notable. And it is a reminder, even if you are not in a dedicated core tech job role, just how important it is to invest in digital skills, because it certainly positions you for more work opportunities, and it makes you a stronger candidate for companies that are hiring. Mm-hmm.
Well, this is a good place to wrap up. Tim, thank you as always for sharing your insight on this research with us.
Great. Thanks, Andrea.
And viewer, thank you for tuning in. We will join you here next month for another Tech Jobs Report from CompTIA.